Tonight, a most disturbing story. In fact, it's worse than a disturbing story. It involves prison guards in New Jersey, about 24 of them, accused of taking half a dozen women inmates, beating them, and then stripping at least one of them, dragging her to a shower, and then sexually assaulting her. So far, just 3 guards are facing charges of just misconduct so far. A full-blown state investigation into this prison of horrors is now underway. Here's Eyewitness News reporter Darla Miles.
Shortly before midnight on January 11th, more than 24 officers at Edna Mahan forcibly removed a number of inmates from their prison cells. The officers were organized into groups known as extraction teams.
The New Jersey Attorney General says there were extraction teams, officers at the Edna Mahan Correctional Facility in Hunterdon County, who they say attacked inmates who were already following directions.
We allege that they deployed pepper spray, rushed into the inmate's cell, and beat several of the victims without justification.
3 of those officers have now been charged. Amir Bethea, Anthony Valvano, and Luis Garcia, charged with second-degree official misconduct, which carries a mandatory 5-year sentence. New Jersey Attorney General Gabeer Graywall announced the arrest and charges Thursday afternoon.
One of the most troubling extractions was led by Sergeant Bethea. During the removal, one of the officers under his supervision, Officer Luis Garcia, allegedly struck a victim approximately 28 times with his closed fist.
Once the violence ended, Sergeant Bethea and Sergeant Valvano both attempted to cover it up by filing false reports about the incident.
This indictment only involves 2 victims, but investigators say 6 inmates have come forward so far, some who even suffered concussions and an eye fracture. And investigators say not only was the assault captured on surveillance video, but say some of the corrections officers recorded it on their cell phone.
We are bringing the charges we brought today to send a strong deterrent message.
So far, the charges have come specifically in regards to 2 of the women that were assaulted. At least six women have come forward. I'm fairly certain there are more than that, you know, and I'm sure that this isn't just this one incident. They have a history at this Edna Mahan correctional facility of this sort of brutal tactics. And you got more than 24 guards implicated in the cover-up as well, and I'm sure, you know, again, more guards implicated in the assaults as well if it expands out to include at least those 4 other women that have come forward with reports of assault. I know that, as I mentioned there, one woman was punched with a closed fist, you know, 28 times, many of the blows to her head. A black trans woman that was one of the victims of these assaults had her head repeatedly stomped on by these prison guards. So, you know, of course, when, you know, these things just are will always end up, you know, disproportionately impacting the more marginalized you are. That's why intersectionality, you know, we talk about is so important, because the layers of intersectionality there just make you a bigger target for systemic injustice. And so, yeah, this was just a particularly horrendous, story that I thought kind of went a little bit too under the radar for my liking. And I just wanted to make sure that we highlighted it and called some attention to this abuse. This is why when we talk about, you know, abolishing prisons, and this was the thing with like Joe Biden, you know, ending the federal contracts for private prisons, that all that did was when Joe Biden signed that executive order ending federal private prison contracts, all that did was move 14,000 prisoners out of private prisons and into, public prisons. And the thing is that, you know, these prisons or state, you know, into state private prisons and out, you know, or sorry, they're federal prisoners. They'll go into other federal public prisons. Sorry. And all it does is just move the prisoners out of from one to the other. And the problem is that even, you know, this isn't a federal prison, but even federal prisons have these sort of abuses and issues. And so, you know, the problem is people being detained in this way in the culture and the system of imprisonment in the extremely punitive system of imprisonment that we have in here. It's not focused on rehabilitation. People oftentimes come out more violent than they went in. The recidivism rate, we have the highest recidivism rate in the entire world. That's the rate of people that get out of prison and then wind up back in there. And so, you know, it's not enough to talk about, like, when you talk about, oh, we're going to end federal prison for, you know, private federal contracts for private prisons. Great. That's like a golf clap worthy, you know, gesture, but it doesn't in any way fundamentally change the system. And the problem is our prison system itself, and even public prisons are at issue here. State prisons are at issue here. And so, yeah, just wanted to make sure, you know, just got to highlight these things to show that it's you put people in with, you give people power over other people like this, and it's going to be abused. In particular, I think it's kind of heinous that you have, you know, men as guards over women in these women's prisons. I don't know how we justify that. I mean, that's a particularly, there's already an inherent power imbalance there, and then you go and you add the power of authority into there. That's extremely frightening. So yeah, you know, any thoughts?
I agree. I also am on team abolition because of exactly this. It's there's not really much to say because you nailed it so perfectly. You know, our prison system is completely broken. It's not to rehabilitate people at all. This is what happens. This is what happens. And this is why, you know, when they say all cops are bastards, you know, the prison guards are right in there with them because they do shit like this. They are cops as well. They just are stationed to one place where they can abuse people. They're not, no one, I'm sure there's like one or two out there who think that they're going there and they're caring about people, but as a whole, the entire system, it's rotten. It's rotten.
Yeah.
We need a real change. Real change.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And that's systemic change, you know? And one thing I'll just note about the whole, like, Biden doing the, you know, ending federal contracts for private prisons. It's about 4 to 8% of all prisoners in the country are held in private prisons. It's a mix of state and federal. So, you know, it's not even all of that 8% isn't in federal prisons. Again, when he did that order, it impacted 14,000 people all total. All right. And that's only, again, a very small fraction of the overall prison population. And all it did was move them out of one prison system and into another prison system, which has its own set of issues and abuses. All right. There's still all types of privatization and incentives for people to profit off of prisons. We have legalized slavery in our prison system. You know, we literally, through the 13th Amendment, have carved out an exception for slavery through the prison system. So, you know, prisoners are exploited in every way, shape, and form that they can be, and, you know, disenfranchised, have their right to vote taken away, and many of them for nonviolent crimes. You know, many of these people are locked away for nonviolent crimes, and it's drug offenses. And so, you know, I just think what Biden could have done in that same executive order, you know, right now where there's real numbers in private detention centers are in the immigration are essentially immigration concentration camps that we have now. These ICE detention centers, 70% of all detainees, of all federal detainees, immigration detainees are held in privately operated detainment centers. All right. I mean, I'm being really nice and calling these things detainment centers. They are concentration camps. All right. They concentrate a population into very small, very, you know, dense spaces, and revoke all of their civil liberties away. So, 70% of all ICE detainees are held in private detention centers. If Biden would have signed an executive order that included those people, they wouldn't have been able to simply move these people from one facility to another. You would have to, honestly, you have to let them go. You just have to let them go, which is what we used to do. We usually, you know, you get these people, you take them in, and then they're allowed to move, you know, go and be with family. You know, do you have a family member or somebody that you can stay with? That's the typical process, is to let them come in and then let them, you know, you process them, and then you let them stay out in the community with family and stuff, and just summons them back to court, right? And they're more, you know, they'll come back, they appear, they come back or whatever. What we can't say is like, oh, we need to hold them and abuse these people in the meantime and use them for slave labor as well, because they're also being used for slave labor as well. So if Biden was serious about trying to help people in prisons or being people, you know, being imprisoned, he would have included immigrants, you know, immigration detention centers, ICE detention centers in that executive order. And he didn't, because he's not really serious about changing anything about the, you know, the fundamental underlying system. It's all about, you know, how do I do the absolute least to get the pat on the back and the praise of the liberals and get them back to sleep so that we can keep on, you know, doing all these same civil rights abuses that we do, so yeah, that's my, my thoughts on that. And it's really unfortunate, that, you know, that these prison guards are allowed to have this kind of authority and power over people. And I just want to point out too, by the way, as you saw in that, those prison guards, there was a Black prison guard, you know, a Black prison guard, a Latinx prison guard, and a white prison guard. All right. So this is the issue with the left versus liberals, right? The left is talking about, you know, defunding the police, abolish ICE, you know, prison abolition. But, and I have a different, you know, I have a slightly, like, I don't go all the way to prison abolition, to be honest. Like, I still think we're going to need something in the way of a place to hold people that are violent criminals, where we can, you know, where we can separate them from society to protect the rest of people. Like, I do think that the government has a mandate to do something like that. You know, it has, you know, what we're talking about, like abolishing prisons as we know them today, right? Yeah. And as we handle them today, because other countries are not so violent in their prisons, and they treat prisoners like human beings too. It's not a totally dehumanizing process whereby, you know, all your rights are stripped away. You're stripping away their right to freedom of movement and freedom in their autonomy. That should be enough. You know, you take away their ability to be dangerous to the rest of society, and that should be enough. And then it should be about rehabilitation. And I just want to point out that here you have, you know, with the left, we're talking about abolishment. With liberals, they're talking about just diversifying the oppressive class, right? Diversify your oppressors. Yeah. All we need is Black faces in high places, right? We just need more Black prison guards and more Latino and Hispanic prison guards and more women prison guards, more
cops.
Yeah. Exactly, right? So this is all that
black,
sort of hash.
A Black police chief.
Exactly. We had Daniel Cameron, the Black attorney general that completely abuses power to make sure that Breonna Taylor's murderers got off scot-free. So, you know, the idea that Black faces in high places, or that, you know, rainbow capitalism or diversifying the oppressors has any positive impact. It, you know, usually talking about Fred Hampton, like I would usually, this is the time where I like to play the clip of, you know, Fred Hampton. He talks about Papa Doc in Haiti and how, you know, Papa Doc led a revolution, a successful revolution in Haiti, and then he turned around and then he oppressed his people the same way that the white people were oppressing his people, right? And if you had asked those people in Haiti, hey, would are you concerned about the color of the foot and the boot on your neck? You know, they would say, no, I just want the boot off my damn neck, right? I just don't want to be oppressed. I don't care what the race of the person that's oppressing me is, all right? So, you know, this is why, like, yeah, I just had to highlight that and make sure people just see that racial diversity doesn't change the underlying system, all right? Even in representation, and, you know, representation can be nice. It can be a nice thing, but it does not change the underlying system. That's not systemic change. And
one without the other. You can't have one without the other. Like, exactly. Like if you have, you know, if you focus just on the systemic, then like you're gonna get shit done. People are gonna be really depressed, you know, like that other shit, that interpersonal shit matters on a day-to-day basis as to how we exist as human beings, as to how we emotionally are, so we can go out there and fight these fights that need to be fought as activists and people who are out there fighting the good fight. We need to fix that other shit. But the systemic shit, that's the shit that will actually change things in an impacting way. You know what I always say about putting a Band-Aid on a bullet hole, and I appreciate the interpersonal shit, the systemic shit, that is what actually matters.